Now, let's try looking at this numerical on computing the premium based on the profit targeting. A life insurance company issues a 3-year unit-linked endowment policy, life aged 45. Okay. So, let me understand, the term is 3 years. Type is unit linked endowment assurance policy, age is 45 years. Level premiums are payable yearly in advance. Okay, if I try to look out for year 1, year 2, year 3, the premiums, level premium, so probably let me assume that the premium is some amount, right? I'll assume that the premium is some amount of, so let's call it P, right? Which means in this case, this is going to be the premium in each of the years. So just for time being, let me understand it as 10,000. So we'll change it later for better understanding purpose, probably, or you can make it as a variable P, because here we have to compute that premium itself. Okay, in the first year, 35% of the premium is allocated to the units. So here, so let's call this as a unit fund directly, right? So the allocation, I am only looking at 35% in the first year. So 35% of the P is the allocation in the first year. Whereas in the second and the third years, we are talking about 105% being allocated. So it's as good as 1.05 P in both the cases. The units are subjected to a bid offer spread of 5%. So based on this, I can compute the bid offer spread, which is 5% of the allocated amount. So the bid offer spread in each of the years is going to be this much. And annual management charge, we are computing it as 0.5%, but that would be levied after the fund value, before, I mean, once we look at the invested amount, right? And which means I also require beginning of the periods, a fund value that is there, beginning of the period. So let me look at one more element here. Fund value at the beginning of the period. Initially it is zero, but after that depends on the fund value that gets accumulated each of the years, right? Okay, annual management charge of 0.5% of the bid value of the units is deducted at the end of each year. Management charges are deducted from the unit fund before the death and the surrender benefits are paid. So that is where the management charge is deducted, before the benefit and death and surrender charges are paid. Policy holder dies during the term of the policy, the death benefit of the bid value of the units is payable at the end of the year of death, which means there is no additional benefit that, or additional costs that need to be borne by the insurance company, because it's the death value, the bid value of the units is what is being paid at the end of the year of death. So there is not much of a loss or additional cost that is borne by the insurance company. On surrender or survival to the end of the term, the bid value of the units is payable at the end of the year of exit. Even here also there is no issue. It's only the the bid value of the units is typically being paid. Company uses the following assumptions. The rate of growth of assets in the unit fund. So probably a few more assumptions. The unit fund growth, it is assuming it as 5%. Non-unit fund growth, it is assuming it as 4%. AM92 ultimate mortality tables are being used. Independent rates of withdrawal. Now, probably here I also require a kind of multiple decrement table, because here there are two forms of decrements that are occurring. So probably let me look at the 3 years, 45, 46, 47, because the policy is issued for 45-year-old person. Now we are saying that the independent rates of withdrawal are 5% per annum. So in each of the years, the independent rate of withdrawal is going to be 5%. But I am following AM92 mortality, means I can find out the independent rates of death also. QX, the independent rates of death, I can find from the same AM92 mortality tables ultimate. So the QX I'll get for 45, 46, 47, 0.001465. 0.001622, 0.001802. So these are the independent rates of mortality. Then we have initial expenses as 250. And renewal expense is 50 on both the years. So probably if I am looking at on the other side, the non-unit fund, right, first thing I will use here is unallocated premium, which would actually come out as the premium amount minus the allocated. So the unallocated premium is coming up as one of the elements. Then we also have the bid offer spread that comes out at the beginning, which is this amount, and on the top of it the insurance company is incurring a few expenses. The expenses are probably 250 in the first year, and we are talking about 50 in each of the remaining 2 years. So based on this, we are talking of the balance, right? Whatever the expenses are, on the top of it we are talking about the balance, 6500 plus 175 minus 250. This is what is coming out to be the balance, and this balance is invested to fetch some interest. Now the interest, we are saying for the non-unit fund, we are talking about 4% growth rate. So we are going to generate this much of interest on all these things, which means, and at the same time I'm also getting my management charge. Okay, so for the getting the management charge, again I have to work out here, wherein I have to look out for the balance here. The balance is telling me that the allocated premium minus the bid offer spread, this is the balance that is there, which would be invested to earn some interest. And I am seeing that the interest on the unit fund is somewhere around 5%. So this is the interest that the fund is earning, right? So basically I am looking at the fund value before the management charge, which will come out as this particular balance plus the interest part, and probably whatever is the balance that is there at the beginning of the period. Right, the balance that is there at the beginning of the period will get added up, and say this is the fund value at the beginning before the management charge. Out of this, I'll take the management charge, which would be 0.5% of the fund value before. So, which means I can very well work out the fund value after the management charge, which will work out to be this number minus this. So, these are the fund values after the management charge, and from the year 2 onwards, the initial fund value is going to be, I will include even this as a part of, so the fund value is going to change in this way. And what I am saying is the management charge each of the years is going to be this number. So, which is also a kind of income to the fund, which is also telling me that the overall, right, that the overall, if I am looking at the cash flows, end of the year cash flows, it is simply coming out as whatever the balance that has been there, there is an interest on the top of it, there is a management charge that is there on the top of it. And remember, there is no other expense that is typically incurred. Right? There is no other expense, especially relating to the death or surrender. There is no guaranteed amount that needs to be paid, which means there is no responsibility from the insurance company in terms of making any forms of settlement, right? Initial expense, renewal expense, initial commission is there, right? Initial commission is there, which is 20% of the first premium. So initial expense only, let me put up the commission also, which is 20% of the first premium. Okay, so this is happening to be, and renewal commission is 2.5% of the second and third year's premium. All right. So, 2.5% of the second and third year's premium. So, these are the numbers that are coming out. So, even these two are addressed. The company sets premiums so that the net present value of the policy is 15% of the annual premium. So, basically, the target is profit margin, or net present value of the profit of the policy is 15% of the annual premium. So I require the net present value as 15% of the annual premium amount. And I need a risk-based discount rate of 8%. Calculate the premium for the policy on the assumption that company does not zeroize the future negative cash flow. So these are the cash flows that have come. Now we also need to understand here, though there is no death or maturity benefits, right, a few things. On surrender to the end of the term, the bid value of the units is payable at the end of the year of exit. Means surrender is not happening throughout. So probably it is like I could very well look at the dependent probabilities now. If I have to compute AQXD, I can directly take it as, I don't need a QXD times 1 minus of QX surrender. Because the surrender is happening only at the end of the year. So I can very well take it as QXD itself. Whereas if I'm looking at surrender, AQXS, probably I'll take it as QXS into 1 minus QXD, because the death benefit, what about the death? Death benefit at the end of the year of death, even if the deaths are typically occurring across, probably uniformly distributed over the year, I need not look at the surrender being uniformly distributed across the year. So basically, the dependent probability is now AQ. If I really want AQX for death, I'll take it as simple as QX for death only. Whereas in case of AQXW or AQX surrender, yes, or probably here also, let me call it as surrender only. So AQXS will come out as QXS times 1 minus of QXD. So the AQXS will play a slightly different numbers across. So based on these two, I can find out APX. Only for finding out APX, I require to compute these. So I'll take it as 1 minus of these two. 1 minus of these two, giving me 0.94886 in case of the first and 0.948288 in case of the last. So based on this, I can find out the proportion of the in-force policies. So initially, if I'm talking about it as 1, for the next year, I'm at the beginning of the period, the number of policies that are in-force is around 94.8%, and it is going up to 89.9% of the policies that are in-force. Which means that is the numbers that I can take, the probability of in-force, right? I'll simply consider the probability of in-force policies here. Here I'll take it as 1, here I'll take it as 0.94, and here I'll take it as this. And at the same time, I can also take the discount factor, which I'll look at it with respect to 1 by 1 plus 8% being the discount factor. So this I'll from here onwards I'll look at it as 1 by 1 plus 0.08, so 85 point something and 79 point something. So these are the discount factors. So which means I can find out the expected present value of the profit, which directly comes out as the sum product of these being the cash flows, these being the probabilities, and these being the discount factors. So expected present value of the profit is working out to this particular number. And I want the profit percentage now. Profit percentage is nothing but the expected present value divided by the premium. Now, all that I want is either this profit percentage needs to be 15%, or I want the expected present value of the profit to be around 1500. So I'll try to adjust the stuff. So probably yes, if this becomes 2000, the expected present value of the profit is around 27%. So this is what I can go ahead in terms of working out, right? The allocations, bid offer spreads, the balance, the interest, the fund values, the unallocated premiums. So all these things we can really look at. The profit percentage is still somewhere around 27%. Now this is where I'm more interested in looking at. The profit percentage needs to be around 15%. So I can very well play around And if at all I'm relying more on a tool like Excel, probably I could very well say the profit percentage needs to be 15% where I would be altering the premiums. So it's working out somewhere around 1144 if the premium is being set somewhere at around 1144. That is where I can work out that the profit percentage, that is where I am able to work out the profit percentage to close to, right, to close to 15%. But either I could manually solve this entire in terms of piece, obviously if I am starting on a pen and paper kind of a mode, I may have to go step by step everything in the form of P and then finally solving for P. But because I have used the spreadsheet, I have started with some assumption, and based on that I have used the goal seek to simplify the calculations for us. Right, in this case the cash flows, yeah, the first, second and the third year's cash flows, there are negative. So probably it could very well result in adjusting or zeroization of those cash flows, setting the reserves, which means the profit margin could still go down. But here we have taken an assumption quite comfortably that the company is not doing a zeroization of the future expected negative cash flows. That's the reason I can take it as it is in terms of the computation. Right, so this is how based on the profit that I have targeted, based on the profit that I have set, we can do a step-by-step workout in terms of setting what should be the premium that needs to be charged so that the overall profit is going to be some percentage of the annual premium or NPV of the premium, expected present value of the premiums or whatever. All right.